Hi, let's talk about leukocytes. Leukocytes, or white blood cells, are responsible for modulating immunity within the body. Leukocytes come in two different varieties. There are granular leukocytes, those that contain tiny little granules that can be degranulated from the cell or ejected from the cell, and agranular leukocytes, those that appear smooth under light microscopy and do not contain those granules that can be degranulated. The granular leukocytes, again, are our good friend Ben. They are the basophils, eosinophils, and neutrophils. And the agranular leukocytes include the lymphocytes, so those T cells, B cells, natural killer cells, and monocytes, those antigen-presenting cells. Most leukocytes, but not all leukocytes, are capable of phagocytosis. Phagocytosis is the process of a cell eating something else. And so more often than not, these white blood cells are capable of eating pathogens or even defunct and malfunctioning other cells and pieces of cellular machinery. They're also capable of chemotaxis, meaning they're able to pick up on a signal and move toward it, and emigration, which means they're able to leave a blood vessel in order to attack a particular pathogen. As you may recall, there are two major types of blood stem cell. We have myeloid stem cell and lymphoid stem cell. And what's interesting is that not all leukocytes are derived from one or the other. They're actually derived from both. And what we see is that our granular lymphocytes and monocytes are derived from myeloid stem cells, whereas our lymphocytes are derived from lymphoid stem cells. Light microscopy, or using a light microscope to view tissues and their constituent cells, is only possible through the use of certain dyes and stains so that we can highlight the cells and their features. One very popular stain is called hematoxylin and eosin, or just H&E for short. Hematoxylin is going to stain basic structures blue, whereas eosin is going to stain acidic structures red. Now, you may have noticed that a lot of these leukocytes have that base ending of phil. That's a form of philic, meaning loving. And so a cell that is an eosinophil is eosinophilic, meaning that it is loving of eosin dye. And so these show up as more red or, more often, pink cells. Basophils absorb more of the hematoxylin dye, the basic stain, and so they typically show up as a blue or sometimes a purple. Whereas neutrophils aren't partial to either eosin or hematoxylin, and they show up as an intermediate between pink and blue. Now, each of these types of granular leukocytes has a particular specialization within the blood. Neutrophils are the most abundant type of leukocyte. They're the first on the scene, and they're in the greatest number. Their specialty is dealing with bacteria, and their granules contain a bactericide. And so neutrophils are bacteria specialists. Eosinophils are an intermediate in terms of their ubiquity within the blood. And their specialty, their degranulation, is going to involve the release of substances such as histamine. And they are involved in allergic responses. And more often than not, are specialists in dealing with endoparasites, such as schistosomes. And then finally, for this slide, basophils are the least common leukocyte. Their granules also contain substances such as histamine, some serotonin, and they're involved in modulating allergic responses. But more often than not, their specialty is for ectoparasites, such as fleas and ticks and the like. The agranular leukocytes, in terms of large-scale categories, are the lymphocytes and the monocytes. The lymphocytes are those that are involved in adaptive immunity. Adaptive immunity is when an individual has an experience with an antigen, then becomes primed to deal with the antigen, and then dispatches the antigen via T cells and B cells. Monocytes are a category of leukocyte that involve antigen-presenting cells, such as macrophages and dendritic cells. These are cells that are capable of phagocytosis, and what they'll do is they'll engulf a pathogen, they'll digest it within, and then they'll put pieces of that pathogen up on major histocompatibility complexes on the surface of the cell, and then present that to other elements of the immune system, such as T cells and B cells, for an adaptive response. So a clinician might take a whole blood count. They might look at the overall hematocrit and the overall level of leukocytes. And in terms of the gross level of leukocytes, an individual might be within a typical range, or they might have an elevated level of leukocytes, and that's known as leukocytosis. Or they may have a deficit of leukocytes, and that's known as leukopenia. Each of these may be grossly indicative of different problems. And knowing how these leukocytes specialize can give us some clues. So for instance, and I don't want to get bogged in the details of this, neutrophils, as bacteria specialists, when their levels are elevated, are indicative of bacterial infections. Lymphocytes, when their levels are elevated, may be indicative of a viral infection or an exposure to a substance that might lead to a mutation, such as radiation or particular types of bioactive substances. Monocytes, being antigen-presenting cells, might be indicative of bacterial, viral, or fungal infections when their levels are elevated. And eosinophils and basophils, as their levels appear elevated, may be indicative of an endoparasitic invasion. So we've introduced you to the leukocytes, the primary actors, and what their specialties are, and talked a little bit about their significance clinically. Let's continue to build a robust picture of these formed elements and later explore the role of thrombocytes or platelets within the blood. Thank you.